డియర్ ఫ్రెండ్స్, వెల్కమ్ టు ఈపీజీ పాఠశాల. ఐఆమ్ ప్రొఫెసర్ కోరాడ సుబ్రహ్మణ్యం ఫ్రమ్ హైదరాబాద్ సెంట్రల్ యూనివర్సిటీ. ఇన్ ద సబ్జెక్ట్ ఇండియన్ కల్చర్, ది సోషల్ అండ్ కల్చరల్ హిస్టరీ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా. టుడే వీఆర్ గోయింగ్ టు డిస్కస్ ది హిందూ ఫ్యామిలీ సిస్టమ్. ఇన్ ఇండియా ది ఫ్యామిలీ సిస్టమ్ ఈస్ టోటల్లీ డిఫరెంట్. వీఆర్ గోయింగ్ టు డిస్కస్ నేచర్ ఆఫ్ ఫ్యామిలీ, హెడ్ సక్సెషన్, జాయింట్ ఫ్యామిలీ, రిలేషన్స్ అండ్ ఫీచర్స్. ఫస్ట్ ఆఫ్ ఆల్, ది కాన్సెప్ట్ ఆఫ్ కుటుంబ ఆర్ ఫ్యామిలీ ఈజ్ యూనిక్ టు ఇండియన్ ట్రెడిషన్. వన్ వుడ్ ఫైండ్ ఏ క్లోజ్లీ నిటెడ్ రిలేషన్ ఎమంగ్ డిఫరెంట్ మెంబర్స్ ఆఫ్ ఎ ఫ్యామిలీ బేస్డ్ ఆన్ ఎవర్ లాస్టింగ్ మ్యూచువల్ ఎఫెక్షన్. దెన్ ది ఫోర్ పిల్లర్స్ ఆఫ్ హ్యూమన్ లైఫ్ we have discussed in another module, namely dharma, artha, kama and moksha are detailed in shruti and different smritis or dharma shastras, and all the people are bounden by these seminal works. A householder is considered to be helping people of all other three kinds of ashramas, that is brahmacharyam, వానప్రస్థం అండ్ సన్యాసం. సో ది హౌస్ హోల్డ్ లైఫ్ ఆర్ గార్హస్థ్యం ఈజ్ కన్సిడర్డ్ టు బి ది సుపీరియర్ ఎమాంగ్ వెన్ కంపేర్డ్ విత్ రెస్ట్ ఆఫ్ ది త్రీ. దెన్ వీ హ్యావ్ టు డిస్కస్ యాక్చువల్లీ యాజ్ టు వాట్ ఈజ్ ఏ ఫ్యామిలీ, అండ్ అకార్డింగ్ టు ఇండియన్ ట్రెడిషన్ ద ఇన్ ఇంట్రడక్షన్ లెటర్స్ టచ్ సర్టెన్ ఆస్పెక్ట్స్ విచ్ ఆర్ వెరీ ఇంపార్టెంట్. అప్ టు ఎన్ ఏజ్ ఆఫ్ 5 లాలయేత్ పంచవర్షాణి దశవర్షాణి తాళయేత్ షోడశే వర్షే ప్రాప్తే పుత్రం మిత్రవదాచరేత్. దిస్ ఈస్ ది ట్రెడిషన్. సో అప్ టు 5 ఇయర్స్ ఆఫ్ ఏజ్ ది చిల్డ్రన్ షుడ్ నాట్ బి, ఐ మీన్ షుడ్ బి టేమ్డ్ రెదర్ వి షుడ్ నాట్ పనిష్ ఫర్ ఎనీ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ మిస్టేక్ ఆన్ దేర్. దెన్ ఆఫ్టర్ 5 ఇయర్స్ ఫర్ 10 ఇయర్స్, దట్ ఈస్ అప్ టు ది ఏజ్ ఆఫ్ 15, వన్ మే గివ్ స్లైట్ పనిష్మెంట్ టు ఏ చైల్డ్. దెన్ ఆఫ్టర్ when the child attains the age of 16, then he should be treated on a par with a friend, and one should not try to punish or do anything or hurt the feelings of the child, whether both male or female. This is according to our shastra. And then about the wealth also, there is a very good verse. Uttamam swarjitam vittam madhyamam pitrarjitam అధమం భ్రాతృవిత్తంచ స్త్రీవిత్తమధమాధమం. వాట్ ఎవర్ వెల్త్ యు హ్యావ్ ఎక్వైర్డ్ ఆన్ యువర్ ఓన్ బై యువర్ ఓన్ ఎఫర్ట్, దట్ ఈస్ ది బెస్ట్. ఇఫ్ యు హ్యావ్ రిసీవ్డ్ సంథింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ యువర్ ఫాదర్ ఆర్ ఫోర్ ఫాదర్స్, దెన్ ఇట్ ఈస్ ఆఫ్ మీడియం టైప్. దెన్ ఇఫ్ యు గెట్ ది వెల్త్ ట్రాన్స్ఫర్డ్ ఆర్ బై అదర్ మీన్స్ ఫ్రమ్ యువర్ బ్రదర్స్, దెన్ ఇట్ ఈస్ కన్సిడర్డ్ టు బి ఏ బ్యాడ్ వన్ మీన్. Then the if it is the wealth of a lady you are going to acquire, that is nichati nicha or very very bad, most I mean very severely that is restricted. That means one should not touch the wealth of a woman that is here. Then after that what happens, ardhangi, there is a term that is very popular, well known to people. What is this? Ardha means half, anga means body, so ardhangi means half of the body. Wife is considered to be the half of the body of her husband. That means after marriage there are no two persons but for the physical separation. There is, according to Indian tradition, there is one and only one. That means in Indian tradition, strictly speaking, there is no question of divorce. No, a person cannot simply give up, send her wife outside, or can say no, I don't have any relation, I don't know. Ardhangi, she is half. What does it mean? The suggested meaning is that in terms of dharma, artha and kama, these three things, the wife has got equal rights. A person does not give money to his wife, rather the wife takes. That means both are equal. There is no superiority or inferiority between a wife and husband. This is clearly stated. Adhova esha atmano yatpatni. This is clearly stated in Taittiriya Samhita as well as Shatapatha Brahmanam, in two branches of Veda. And Jaimini, the author of Paramimamsa, which deals with the earlier parts of Veda, he clearly says that a single karma performed by wife and husband, and the norm is dampatyoho sahadhikaraha. Dampati, the word itself means jaya cha patischa, wife and husband. Both have performed a rite, R-I-T-E rite, that is a karma. Then both of them will have the same phalam. The phalam will be distributed between them. And another great sage, Apastamba, says, pranigrahanat sahatvam karmasu punyaphaleshu cha dravyeshu cha. So he says, after marriage, this is called generally panigrahanam, holding the hand, that is the literal meaning. Panigrahanam is marriage. Once a boy and girl got married, the bride and bridegroom got married, then there will be only one person. There are not two. So the wife, whatever punya karma or any good deed that results in punyam is performed by husband, the wife will partake of the result of that punya karma, but not papa karma. That is a suggested meaning. If the husband commits any sinful thing, any papa, wife is not going to partake of that result. Therefore, and she will have the same rights in all the karmas and punyam, and as well as dravya. Dravya means anything that is there. For example, it may be a house, it may be wealth, it may be cattle, whatever may be, in whatever form it may be, dravyam, that the wife will partake of it. And in all the activities, she will be there. Then, marriage and family affairs. This marriage is a rough translation of vivaha as far as Indian tradition or culture is concerned, Vedic tradition is concerned, because in other cultures, living together by two people belonging to the different genders is called marriage roughly. Whereas in Indian culture, this will not go. That will be there, living together will be there. So, by taking this kind of similarity only, vivaha is translated as marriage. Otherwise, it has got a lot of meaning. So, according to Indian culture, one should get married after completion of his education and taking the permission of guru. And if the one more thing is said in Manusmriti, if the ladies are respected in the family, then all the devatas, all the gods will be enjoying stay in that family. If the ladies are put to trouble, or if they are weeping, if they are suffering, if they are disturbed in any way, then the gods will not be live. They will not enjoy the stay. That's all. So this is clearly stated in Manusmriti. And if the ladies are simply weeping or suffering in a family, then not only that family, but the entire clan or vamsha, to the entire clan, will get perished. This is clearly stated. Yatra narijastu pujyante ramante tatra devataha, etc., etc. This is clearly said in Manusmriti. Therefore, a person desiring prosperity should please the ladies by offering ornaments or clothes, good food, etc., at different occasions. And the conjugal relation. Bhrigu, author of Manusmriti, asserts that the house wherein the wife and husband have mutual satisfaction would certainly shine and with auspicious occasions forever. So the conjugal relation or dampatya sambandha between wife and husband is very important for a harmonious life of the family. So he also praises the second ashrama, this is garhasyam, we have already said, that is very useful for other ashramas. And grihasthashrama is on the top of ashramas, as the people belonging to the other three ashramas, that is brahmacharyam, vanaprastham and sannyasam, would depend on this garhasya grihastha or household person for their food, etc. Then the daily routine. Manusmriti clearly says, Brahme Muhurte Bujheta. One should get up, wake up early in the morning. Brahma Muhurta, it is also called roughly 4:30 a.m. in the early morning, and think about dharma and artha. What are the things to be attended? What should he do? What are the financial matters to be discussed or to be addressed? And then the related physical labor, and as well as Vedanta, are the putting efforts to attain jnanam. All these things should be done early in the morning. So ladies should not be left without protection. This is very important. Actually, Nastri Swatantriya Marhati is a dictum that is often quoted and often mistranslated. A lady doesn't have independence, that is how it is translated, but that is wrong. It is just the last leg of the verse. The full verse goes like this. Bala, when the girl is young, then she should be protected by the Pita. Pita rakshati kaumare, bharta rakshati yuvvane, putrascha vardhake vayasi, nastri svatandriya marhati. This is the verse. So, the father is directly responsible for the protection of the girl during young age. When she will become a youth, when she enters the age of, youth, then it is the responsibility of the husband to protect her, to offer protection. During old age, also she should be protected by her sons or daughters. And like that, she should be in the protection of any one of these people, father, husband, and sons or daughters. So, a lady or a woman should not be left without protection. Today, we realize why they said some thousands of years ago, why Bhrigu Maharishi said, careful, careful, you should give protection to a girl. Today, the situation is very bad in India because we did not follow, rather we are not following the dictum that was offered by Bhrigu Maharishi in Manusmriti. Then head of the family. Who is the head of the family? Our Indian tradition clearly says that father is the head of the family. And he is directly responsible for any tenets of dharma, that means non-violence, truthfulness, not stealing, asteyam, cleanliness, etc., mental and physical cleanliness, and control on sense organs, and donation, sympathy, or bhota daya, what you call, and control upon mind and patience. All these virtues should be possessed by a father, and he is directly responsible. Also, one should select a suitable livelihood which is straight and honest. One should not go through backdoor methods, or one should not try to hoard a lot of money or wealth through different means which are not acceptable to Dharma Shastra. Then, family and head and property. As well as the property is concerned, Shruti clearly says that father is the head of the family, and also father is the owner of the property. The sources of acquisition, such as birth, purchase, etc., and the sources of ownership have been known since time immemorial and not started by Shastras. These things are not, started or prescribed by Shastras. These ownership, etc., have been there since time immemorial. Daya and Daya Bhaga, TLN. That is Daya and Dayada. What is Daya? Any property that is to be distributed among the stakeholders is called Daya. And the one who is eligible to receive a portion of the property is called Dayada. So, Dayadas are, just for example, if there is some property, the father, his sons are the Dayadas. So, the wealth acquired by father or from his father or mother, etc., is called Daya. Whereas the people like sons who are entitled to receive a portion of Daya are called Dayadas. And the sons do not have ownership whatsoever on the daya of father as long as he is alive and until he becomes a sannyasin. Sons should not say, I should not claim, this is mine, I want to do this thing. They can't say. There is another school that holds that the son, grandson or great-grandson, they acquire the right of ownership of ancestral property by birth. So partition will not be there, but they have the rights. Sources of ownership. Gautama in his Smriti, called Gautama Smriti, lays down five sources of ownership common to all. Namely, inheritance, that is called rektha in Sanskrit, purchase, partition and seizure, and finding of any treasure. These are the five. Gifts, etc. may be other sources of ownership. Bad source of income and punishment. Manusmriti clearly says, lays down the rule that a Brahmana who gains wealth through teaching or priesthood to a man whom he knows to be a thief is punishable on a par with a thief. That means a thief should not be taught, or a Brahmana should not accept a priesthood to a thief. If at all he accepts, the Brahmana is liable for retribution. Inheritance, authors of Smritis agree that persons other than sons, grandsons, etc. have no right in the wealth of their relatives. Next, this problem with ownership. If sons have ownership by birth in ancestral property, then on the birth of a son, the father cannot perform any Vedic rite that are ordained in Vedas, I mean without the consent of the son. So this goes against the ordinance of Veda. So Devala Smriti is there. Devala is a great sage like Gautama, etc. And he negates the son's ownership during the father's lifetime. There is this kind of thinking. So ownership by birth. Gautama quotes a statement of others which says that the one acquires ownership by birth itself. This is supported by numerous statements of Yajnavalkya, Katyayana, etc. That in the paternal grandfather's wealth, the father and the son have equal ownership, and so the right of the son must be by birth. Then, father in command, as head of the family and its manager, he is called manager, the father has independent authority to spend ancestral wealth for indispensable acts of dharma ordained by Shruti and Smriti texts, that is Veda and Dharma Shastras, for making gifts of affection, for maintenance of the family, and for ridding the family of distress. Similarly, further, the father or the manager of the family can dispose of even immovable property. Generally, he is not allowed to dispose of immovable property, but in certain cases, he is allowed to even dispose of the immovable property by mortgage or sell in a season of distress or for the benefit of the family and for necessary rites such as Shraddha or the marriages of sons, daughters, etc. Then, control and expenditure. The Smritis restrict the owner of the property from making gifts to the detriment of the family. Swam kutumba virodhena deyam. Yajnavalkya Smriti clearly says, see that it does not go against the family or family members. In such a way, you are supposed to, that means, you means the father, who is also considered to be the manager, to spend money. Therefore, property does not comprise only what one can dispose of at one's sweet will, but what is capable of being disposed of as one likes. Then, means of regulating the owner. How to regulate the owner? A person may be prevented from dealing with his property as he likes by the king or by the rules of Shastra or by public opinion or by his own inclinations and the pressure of people who are there around him. There are various grades of limitations of property, such as the father's power, the widow's power, and so on. What a person earns should belong to him, should be his property. Manu, Bharatam, etc. say that there are certain people without wealth. Three persons, namely the wife, the son, and the slave are without wealth, and whatever they earn is for him to whom the three belong. Shabraswami clarifies the above statement of Bhrigu in Manusmriti. This passage does not deny the ownership of the wife or the son in what she or he earns, but is only intended to lay down that the wife or son cannot independently dispose of what she or he earns. That means they have to go on adding to the wealth of the family rather than do something independently. Then limits of partition. This is Dhareshwara, a great sage, holds that when the father desires to make a partition, he may distribute his self-acquired property as he likes among his sons, but as to the property he got from his own father, that is grandfather or of his sons, he has the same ownership that sons have, and he cannot make an unequal division at his sweet will. Then joint family and partition. So Madana Parijata, a great work on this vyavahara or the family affairs, speaks of four times of partition, namely during the father's lifetime as at his choice partition can be done, even against his will, when the mother is past childbearing and the father is free from all sexual desires and does not care for wealth. That means he is about to go for vanaprastham. And then when the father is old or follows the path of adharma or suffers from an incurable disease, then even against his will. And the fourth one is after the father's death. In all these four circumstances, the joint family can make partition. Mithakshara accepts all the above, except the third. Mithakshara is authored by Haradatta Mishra, a great scholar. Then, problem of majority and minority. How to decide as to a person has acquired majority? Partition was generally made when all the stakeholders were major, but it appears that the minority of a stakeholder is not a bar to partition. So Kautilya in Arthashastra says partition takes place when the persons separating have attained majority, but the stakeholders should keep in the custody of the mother's relatives of those stakeholders who are minors, or of the elders of the village, the share of the minors. After all the debts of the family are paid off till the minor stakeholders attain majority. The same rule applies to a member of a joint family that has gone abroad. Then deciding majority. How to decide majority? Who is minor? Who is major? Then Katyayana clarifies that partition is ordained among stakeholders who have attained the age of understanding of worldly affairs. They should be in a position to understand the worldly affairs, and in the case of males, it is 16th year. Some hold that majority ends at the beginning of 16th year, whereas Mithakshara holds that the view that minority ends at the end of the 16th year. So once the son completes 16th year, he is considered as major and he is eligible for partition. So king is the guardian. According to Gautama, Manu, Vasishtha, etc., the king was to guard the property of minors, women and helpless people. King is directly responsible. Then dichotomy of property. Property, according to ancient Hindu law, can be divided into two classes. The one is joint family property and separate property. Joint family property is either ancestral property or property jointly acquired with or without the aid of ancestral property, or property acquired separately but thrown into the common stock. So Mithakshara clarifies, among unseparated brothers, if the common stock be improved or augmented by one of them through agriculture, trade or similar means, an equal distribution nevertheless takes place and a double share is not allocated to the acquirer. Ancestral property. So here ancestral property are apratibandhadaya, this is technically called in Dharma Shastras, is all property inherited by a male from his father, paternal grandfather or paternal great-grandfather, in which, according to Mitakshara school, the sons, grandsons and great-grandsons of the person who inherit it acquire an interest by birth. Ancestral and separate property. If a person obtains a share of the ancestral property on partition, it has been held that it is his separate property. If he has no son, grandson or great-grandson, but if there be any of these, then it is ancestral property in his hands so far as the he and any of his male descendants are concerned. Kinds of separate property. Property inherited from any person other than the father, father's father and further. A gift of a small portion of ancestral movable property made through affection by the father to his issue. Gift or bequest of separate property made by the father to his sons. Gifts and bequests made by other relations and friends, and gifts at the time of marriage. Ancestral property lost to the family and recovered from a stranger by a member of a joint family with his own efforts without assistance from joint family property. Separate earnings and gains of learning of or science, which are technically called vidyadanam, also fall under the head of separate property. So, kind of separate property. There are another kind of shauryadhanam and bharyadhanam, etc. are there. Katyayana distinguishes between shauryadhanam and dvajahurta. Narada and Brihaspati put both under shauryadhanam. So, here Katyayana divides the bharyadhanam, wealth of wife of Narada and Brihaspati into two, namely kanyagata and vaivahika. Vaivahika is of Manu and audvahika of Yajnavalkya are the same. That means at the time of marriage, whatever the girl, the bride gets gifts, etc., that is called audvahika. So, impartible things are there. Manu enumerates the things to be impartible from their very nature. Clothes, vehicles, ornaments, cooked food, water, it is well, etc., women, yoga kshema and ways leading to the house, garden and the like. These are impartible things. Donation at Shraddha. Shraddha is nothing but a death ceremony. And there, Avibhakta Kutumba or joint family and Karta. This is a Hindu undivided family. It is called by income tax people today, HUF. And there will be Karta. This Karta is not stated in Dhammashastras. Generally, father or manager he is called. This in the Smritis and the commentaries, we came across the words Kutumba or Avibhakta Kutumba. Avibhakta means undivided. A family that is not separated. A giant Hindu family consists of all males lineally descended from a common male ancestor and includes their wives and unmarried daughters. A daughter on marriage ceases to be a member of her father's family and becomes a member of her husband's family. Under the Mitakshara, the Hindu stakeholder strictly so called because is a much narrower group than the joint family. It comprises only of those males, etc. Some important features are those males who take by birth an interest in the joint property. Some important features are detailed by Mitakshara. There is in the first place of place unity of ownership. There is also unity of possession and enjoyment. Further, while the family is joint and some stakeholders have many children and others have few or none or some are absent, they cannot complain at the time of partition about some stakeholders having exhausted the whole income and cannot ask for an account of the past income and expenditure. A female cannot be a stakeholder, even if she be the wife or the mother. Another feature is that each stakeholder has a right to enforce a partition. Avibhakta Kutumba, I have discussed, and జాయింట్ ఫ్యామిలీ, దెన్ అవిభక్త కుటుంబాలు జాయింట్ ఫ్యామిలీ అని కర్త. వన్ మోర్ రైట్ ఆఫ్ ఆల్ మెంబర్స్ ఆఫ్ ది జాయింట్ హిందూ ఫ్యామిలీ ఈజ్ ది రైట్ టు బి మెయింటైన్ ఫ్రమ్ ది ప్రాపర్టీ అండ్ ఇన్కమ్ ఆఫ్ ది జాయింట్ ఫ్యామిలీ. ఇఫ్ ఎ సన్ వర్ బార్న్ టు ది ఫాదర్ ఆఫ్టర్ పార్టిషన్ విత్ ది సన్స్, హీ వుడ్ బీ ఎంటైటిల్డ్ టు ది షేర్ టేకెన్ బై ది ఫాదర్. ఇఫ్ ది ఫాదర్ టుక్ నో ఇఫ్ ద ఫాదర్ టుక్ ఏ నో షేర్, దెన్ ది సన్ సో బార్న్ వుడ్ బి ఎంటైటిల్డ్ టు రివోపెన్ ది పార్టిషన్ అండ్ టేక్ ఎ షేర్ ఆఫ్ ది ప్రాపర్టీ రిమైనింగ్ ఆఫ్టర్ టేకింగ్ ఇన్ టు అకౌంట్ ఎక్స్టెన్షన్స్ అండ్ ఎక్స్పెన్సెస్. అడాప్టెడ్ సన్, వాట్ టు డూ? ఏన్ అడాప్టెడ్ సన్, ఇఫ్ అడాప్టెడ్ బై వన్ స్టేక్ హోల్డర్ ఇన్ ఏ జాయింట్ ఫ్యామిలీ ఆర్ బై ఎ సోల్ సర్వైవింగ్ స్టేక్ హోల్డర్ బికమ్స్ అండర్ ది మితాక్షర లా ఏ మెంబర్ ఆఫ్ ది గ్రూప్ ఆఫ్ స్టేక్ హోల్డర్స్ ఫ్రమ్ ది మూమెంట్ ఆఫ్ హిజ్ అడాప్షన్ అండ్ హ్యాస్ ది సేమ్ రైట్ టు డిమాండ్ ఏ పార్టిషన్ యాజ్ ఎన్ ఔరస సన్ ఆర్ బయోలాజికల్ సన్ హ్యాస్. అండర్ ది దాయభాగ లిటరల్లీ మీన్స్ పార్టిషన్ ఆఫ్ వెల్త్. దాయభాగ మీన్స్ పార్టిషన్ ఆఫ్ వెల్త్. ఈవెన్ యాజ్ ఎన్ ఔరస సన్ కెనాట్ క్లెయిమ్ పార్టిషన్ డ్యూరింగ్ హిస్ ఫాదర్స్ లైఫ్ అండ్ సో ఎన్ అడాప్టెడ్ సన్ వుడ్ బీ ఇన్ నో బెటర్ పొజిషన్. ఇఫ్ ఆఫ్టర్ ఎ పర్సన్ అడాప్ట్స్ హీ హ్యాస్ ఎన్ ఔరస సన్, ది అడాప్టెడ్ సన్స్ షేర్ బికమ్స్ రిడ్యూస్డ్ అకార్డింగ్ టు మోస్ట్ కామెంటేటర్స్. వైఫ్ అండ్ పార్టిషన్. అకార్డింగ్ టు యాజ్ఞవల్క్య, ద వైఫ్ కెనాట్ హెర్సెల్ఫ్ డిమాండ్ ఏ పార్టిషన్, బట్ ఇఫ్ ద హస్బెండ్ హిమ్సెల్ఫ్ సెపరేట్స్ హిస్ సన్స్ డ్యూరింగ్ హిస్ లైఫ్ టైమ్, ది వైఫ్ వాజ్ ఎంటైటిల్డ్ టు ఏ షేర్ ఈక్వల్ టు దట్ ఆఫ్ ఎ సన్. ఇఫ్ దేర్ బీ సెవరల్ వైఫ్స్, ఈచ్ గెట్స్ ఏ షేర్ ఈక్వల్ టు దట్ ఆఫ్ ఎ సన్. దెర్ ఈజ్ ఏ ప్రొవిజన్ దట్ ది వైఫ్ ఆర్ వైఫ్స్ మస్ట్ నాట్ బి ఇన్ పొజిషన్ ఆఫ్ స్త్రీ ధనం ప్రాపర్టీ గివెన్ బై ది హస్బెండ్ ఆర్ ది ఫాదర్ ఇన్ లా, and that if there is sridhana then only as much more will be allotted to her as will make her share equal to that of a son. The mitakshara states that at the husband's will the wife also gets a share of the family wealth but not by her own will. Then share of a widow. Vishwarupa an ancient commentator states that the widows of pre-deceased sons and grandsons also should be given the shares that would have been taken by their husbands if living along with his own wives by the father at the time of partition with his sons. In the conclusion, both Dayabhaga and Mitakshara make the widow of a deceased stakeholder a member of the group of the stakeholders. Share of mother or stepmother. When the sons come to a partition after the father's death, the mother or stepmother also is entitled to a share equal to that of a son in the joint property. Grandmother and step-grandmother. A paternal grandmother or step-grandmother cannot herself demand a partition, but when a partition takes place between her son's sons, her own son being dead, or when it takes place when her and the sons of deceased son, she is entitled to a share. Vyasa says the childless wives of the father are declared to be entitled to a share equal to all grandmothers and are declared equal to the mother, not eligible for a share. So impotent persons, outcasts, that is patita they are called, persons blind or deaf from birth, insane persons, idiots, the dumb and those deficient in any organ of the body or sense are entitled to no share according to Manu, Yajnavalkya, Narada, etc. The grounds of disqualification apply to males and females alike as stated by Mitakshara. Eldest son, the Apastamba Dharma Sotram concludes that equal division among sons is the proper mode and that giving a major part of the estate to the eldest son is forbidden by the Shastras. So summary. So now in this module we have discussed as to what a family is and whether a father is the manager of the property, what to do with the joint property, how to deal with the partition, and whether wife, son, etc. have got equal rights or not, what about the rights of adopted sons, widows, etc., etc., and whether the people who are dumb, I mean who have got some problem in bodily limb or the other, are they eligible for partition, etc. So with this we conclude this module. For further information, please visit EPG Pathashala, that e-text on UGC website. Thank you very much.